Six Music.
This is a BBC Radio Six Music documentary. Tighten Up, the story of Trojan Records.
There'll be no strings to bind your hands, darling.
Neville Staple of the Specials was a teenager at the time and remembers the Shebeen parties.
You see how you have these big speaker boxes now, you know, like when you do a gig, you've got the PAs. Well, in Jamaican style, we used to make it like, it was like wardrobes with four speakers in it and tops, you know, toppers, you know, treble. And we used to keep it in a house. One week it might be in somebody's house, next week in somebody else's house. Like, we'd clear out two or three rooms. And when I say clear it out, you put all the furniture in one room, and so it's got an empty room, and you'd have your sound system playing, people would come in, sometimes you'd charge them to come in. In the kitchen, there'd be like a bar where you sell your drinks. Sometimes it'd be ram jam-packed in a house, 200. Honest to God, seriously, it was so packed sometimes, and the music was so loud. They'd start Friday right round till Sunday. Totally illegal, though, you know.
Freddie Notes of the Rudy's fame, an early British reggae band, remembers London's Q Club, a Jamaican music hangout.
The Q Club, all the artists from Tom Jones, Mick Jagger, Gina Washington, Frank Sinatra, you name them, they always come to that club, which was owned by a black man called Count Sucker. I remember one night I was performing and I got in the spirit, and I was just woken out of that with a sound coming from behind me, and I'm saying, Christ, that's how good we are. And when I looked behind me, it was Dizzy Gillespie playing an Egyptian harp. Yeah. Another time again, I performed down there, and the great Muhammad Ali came in, and when he see me, he came up on stage and hold me up. He says, I have the prettiest face and this man have the prettiest feet. Yes.
The late Desmond Dekker was the first Jamaican artist to emerge from this underground UK scene as a star, paving the way forward for labels like Trojan. He hit number 14 in the UK charts with this Rude Boy hit, 007, Shantytown. Freddie Notes remembers him playing at one of his early sold-out gigs.
Desmond was to appear on the stage. So I said, Desmond, take off your tie. He said, no, man. You know, people like to see me. I said, Desmond, take your tie off. I says, you don't know this crowd. I know them. He wouldn't listen. Went on stage. It was a revolving stage. Start turning around and dun, 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 dun. The next minute, a mob go up there and strangling. Blood was coming out through his nose. They were strangling for real. Grab on the tie, you know, and screaming. I have to run up there again and pull them apart, you know, and slack them tie and pull him out. And his manager, which was Tony Cousins at the time, said, oh, Fred, please help Desmond. I said, the next time, you don't wear a tie on stage, you're full. And you look for your big hit record. And these young girls, they want a piece of you.
One of the most exciting things about Jamaican music is how it keeps changing, and around mid-1968, the style changed again into reggae. It had an incredibly infectious beat, the bass line carried the hook, and the melodies became a lot more pop. The recordings were of a much higher standard too. The studios in Jamaica now had better technology due to the financial success of ska and rocksteady. John Holt on the reggae sound.
How the reggae sound came about was created by Toots of the Maytals. He was the first man to ever record a song that has that reggae sound. That's reggae when the guitar is playing it, and the organ playing.
Toots and the Maytals there with Pressure Drop, released on Trojan in 1969. It's around this time in Jamaican music that Trojan really arrived, as rocksteady was turning into early reggae. More and more record producers began to bring songs they'd had hits with in Jamaica to Trojan to release in Britain, hoping they'd sell there too. It was Dandy Livingston's responsibility to touch them up for release.
Yeah, I remember getting tapes from Bonnie Lee, or Trojan rather, getting tapes from Bonnie Lee, Scratch, Lee Perry, and Harry J, Joe Gibbs. But I must say, some of those tapes were very, very crude. The production weren't up to scratch as such, right? And we had to edit out bits and pieces of the tapes, believe it or not, it's true, to make them sound good.
Was Lee Perry's Upsetters with Night Doctor, a 1969 release on Trojan. The BNC Stroke Island partnership at Trojan was working well, and they began to sell more and more records to the West Indian communities and the white scenesters. Former label manager Rob Bell.
Island had the contacts in Jamaica, and BNC had all the music land stores, so they sort of had the distribution. Having the record company in the same building as the people that were running the stores gave you a really tight, fast intercommunication, so you knew immediately when a record was hot or was going to be hot, and you could get it out immediately. What it meant on a purely commercial level was that you had the shop store managers calling in for their orders, asking if certain records were yet available, and what used to happen would be that the sound system guys would get pre-release copies from Jamaica, and they'd build up a huge demand for these things. And if you didn't put the record out immediately, it could die, you know, so it was a question of putting stuff out while it was hot, while it was being asked for. We'd get a record in from Jamaica that we knew was going to be hot, that was being asked for. We'd master it. We didn't bother with tapes or anything. We'd just take the disc down to the mastering studio, and they'd just dub from a disc. We'd put the lacquer in a cab, send it over to the pressing plant in Dagenham, and that evening we'd have, you know, records in our stores and going out to the shops in the morning. So it was a real fast operation. You know, we could turn stuff around really quickly.
A classic Trojan release from this time is John Holt's Alibaba, released in June 1969, and perhaps one of his best. It's immaculately produced by Duke Reid.
My dream last night was about Alibaba with the 40 thieves. Tom, the piper's son, he was there with me. I rode through a valley with a princess by my side. The Duke and the Duchess was there to meet me with a smile. Alice was there in Wonderland, staring far away.
The three blind mice was there with me to tell the teddy bear the tale. The teddy bear came smiling there with a big smile. The little Bo Peep has lost her sheep last night.
John Holt recalls the recording of the track back in Jamaica.
You know, that song came about when we made a rhythm, and then I came to the studio now, and that Mr. Smith, the engineer, said, "Hey, you have a rhythm here that you didn't really voice as yet, you know." So he started playing it, and I just said, "What? Let's go then." Just out of the blue, you know, just out of the blue. I said, "Okay, come, let's go." And, you know, played about 2-3 times for me, you know. And then I find that this Alibaba came to my head. And the moment the guy started playing the rhythm, I just developed a thing like, "My dream last night was about Alibaba." You know, with the 40 Thieves, Tom Tom, the Piper, Sonny Just Nursery Rhymes, and Name of Animals, and stuff like that, that came to my mind. So I just put them on and used a melody around them. It was the first song that I ever recorded straight out of my head.
This is another Upsetters track, Return of Django, that got to number 5 in the UK charts for Trojan in 1969. Produced by the Phil Spector of Jamaican music, Lee Scratch Perry, the success of this record really inspired other Jamaican record producers to get their records released in the UK on Trojan. Singer Dave Barker explains.
There were a lot of producers who wanted to make that English number one, because after Lee Scratch Perry came back from England with his Return of Django, Lee Perry came back to Jamaica in style. He came back with a Jaguar. This Jag was painted green and black. And he came back with all kinds of clothes, you know, velvet trousers and velvet shirts, you know, long sleeve stuffs and certain types of hats and shoes. Being Scratch, he would dress up every day and drive up and down in his Jag, and people would stare at him, and of course the rest of producers would want to also be in that same bag. And Scratch used to drive the Jaguar, even though Scratch couldn't really drive. Scratch would be driving the car, and at times the car would mount the pavement, you know, and people had to run.
Strange thing in Jamaica, it was the producers who were the stars and not the musicians. Rob Bell explains.
I think the most interesting thing about Jamaican record industry is that it's really been producer-driven rather than artist-driven. It was the sound that producers got rather than the identifiable sound of a particular artist. The producer really had a lot more power than an artist. He would have a certain sound, a certain rhythmic thing going, and the artists were, sadly, a little disposable, really.
Reggae singer Little Roy began his career in the late 60s and remembers producer Coxon Dodd's role in the studio.
Coxon wasn't in the studio. It was like Jackie Mitu and the musicians, you know. Coxon wasn't there. A lot of these producers, they produce, they have the business set up, and the songs come back that they are the producers and thing. But sometimes they are not even there when the songs being made. They are just producer by ownership. The musicians were mostly the producers. Jackie Mitu, I would say, was like the producer at Studio One, you know, because he used to do the auditions, he used to choose the songs, he used to arrange everything, you know.
Trombonist Rico Rodriguez remembers the producers simply as financiers.
They had the money to go to the studio, so they become the governor, you know, that sense. The musicians are talented people, but we have no money to go to the studio. So the people who have the money will always get the artists to go to the studios. But after a while, no, you're just happy for the opportunity to go into the studio. Because if you don't go into the studio, it's only the public going to know you by hearsay, or if they are there. But by going into the studio and recording the studio, it makes you well-known.
Many producers were actually accused of taking advantage of the musicians, paying them one-off fees for whole songs with no contracts or even royalties. It was a problem that would haunt Trojan later on. Derek Morgan explains.
Between Juke, Buster, Liquorwanda, they were only paying £10 for a song. Each song you sing is £10. That's it. No royalties, no publishing, nothing. Just £10.
Jamaican music expert Garth White comes to the producer's defense.
To balance the picture for these early and important producers, we must say that they had to carry along with artists who had been successful any number of those whose songs may not have hit, but they still had to be supporting them in one form or another. School fees, clothes, rent, this sort of thing, which would not be stipulated in any contract, right? And which is very hard to calculate. Now, when you have 50 acts like that, of which they conservatively say 15 are really hitting, then the producer has an awesome job to keep the family going.
In 1969, reggae really began an assault on the UK charts. Jamaicans now living in the UK, or British people from Jamaican descent, now had a music playing in Britain that related to them. You know, it's funny, the term British Black, Black British, sort of rolls off the tongue now. But back in the day, it was a very confusing concept. I mean, there was no blueprint for this kind of social experiment. We were like a lost tribe. And it was really these records that saved our souls. I guess even stranger, my white working classmates dug it too. Here's reggae author Michael De Koning.
Desmond Dekker, I mean, did more perhaps than any early artist. 007 made ripples in the late mod market, but once Israelites hit, I mean, everybody heard it. No one could understand what he was saying, but that didn't really matter, and it was chanted around every school and every radio station. Everybody had Israelites. He really cracked the British market, the pop market.
Get up in the morning, slaving for bread, sir, so that every mouth can be fed. Israelite. Get up in the morning, slaving for bread, sir, so that every mouth can be fed.
Oh, Israelite.
The record was also a big hit with a growing new youth movement in the UK at the time, and it was this unlikely new trend that would catapult Trojan from an underground cult label to a full-on chart sensation. It was the time of the skinheads, and we're talking about the fashion version, not the fascist version.
This is your boss, Skinhead, speaking on the skinhead train to Rainbow City. Sit back, relax, have a coke, crack a joke, put on your dancing shoe and listen while your boss, Skinhead, suck it to you. Suck it to me, suck it to me, suck it to me. Skinhead train bound for Rainbow City. Skinhead invasion.
Trojan historian and former skinhead, Michael De Koning.
Why did skinheads adopt reggae? I can't answer. Nobody really can say. The mods picked up on Buster, as we well know, and the skinheads seem to follow this through to keeping in with Jamaican music.
Reggae writer David Katz.
Initially, it sort of comes out of the mod movement, and I suppose a big thing for mods and then for skinheads was about asserting an individuality. So it was about styles of dress, and if you had white working class people in certain working environments, and I think the dress sense, fashion conscious youth in Britain that wanted to assert their individuality partly through the way that they dressed, tapped into the whole kind of rude boy style from Jamaica.
Stop your running about. It's time you straighten right out.
British-based Trojan producer and musician Dandy Livingston had already had success with Rudy, A Message to You, a song about the Jamaican rude boys which had proved a hit with the UK skinheads.
At the time, this was what, 67? The rude boy situation in Jamaica was really bad. Guys were slashing guys with razors and things like that, unfortunately, you know, and it was a direct message, right? Everybody was making rude boy songs.
skinheads adopted the Jamaican rude boy look.
The classic skinhead look was in the daytime, probably a Levi jacket, rolled stay press, shined boots, Dr. Martens preferably, Ben Sherman shirt, braces. Evening wear, you'd go into something like loafers, stay press trousers, once again braces, nice shirt, a Harrington jacket slightly later. A
message to you. Dressing like a skinhead could get you into trouble too.
The school were never very keen on skinheads and were always trying to sort of stamp it out or stamp the uniform out. And we used to get yanked out if we had too short a hair. And I was pulled out at one point for having too short hair and fined 2 shillings and sixpence.
Royce and Edwards, who would later act in the film Quadrophenia, was also a skinhead then.
Part of the skinhead thing was with your crombie, which was part of your attire, is that you had a red silk hanky or a silk hanky. And the funny thing was, the school I used to go to, we had a black uniform, and the crack was that you'd put your red silk hanky in your top pocket, and then when you got into assembly, you'd just flick the top out. And teachers used to hate it. They used to hate it from looking at the stage, looking at all these boys with red silk hankies poking out of their pockets. But then once the assembly's finished, you know, your silk hankies would disappear again, you know, so they couldn't work out who was who anyway.
Stop you running about, it's time you straighten right out.
By 1969, there were skinhead gangs on every housing estate in Britain. The skinheads embraced Jamaican music wholeheartedly, and Trojan sales mushroomed considerably. Producer Bunny Lee.
The skinheads support our West Indian type of music and reggae and ska. We have to thank them, because if it wasn't the skinhead, this music could just be on one stage. They bring it to the forefront of the world, you know? We are glad for that.
Garth White from the University of Jamaica.
We out here in Jamaica were quite surprised when we heard of the level of support to the music and culture given by this young working class group in England. Although, given the anti-status quo mood of the young all over the world at the time, it was not all that surprising. And of course, they helped to popularize the music, because you now had not only an immigrant group vociferously supporting their culture, but a homegrown set of lads who really genuinely enjoyed the music.
Today, many people associate skinheads with racism, but back then, this wasn't the case. Roy Ellis, lead singer with Simmerip, a favourite skinhead band.
The skinhead scene was coming from the working class people. In those days, the proper skinheads are not racists, otherwise they would never listen to black music.
David Katz.
Racism was not a part of the original skinhead movement. And in terms of violence, yeah, I don't know. There's always kinds of animosity between different youth movements, particularly as one movement comes in to replace another. Mods versus rockers, Teds versus skins, whatever it may be. But from what I understand, the violent element and then racist elements come later. Or maybe some would say the movement got hijacked.
However, the skinheads had started to make a name for themselves within the tabloid press. Their intimidating look, coupled with the odd bout of violence, started to tarnish their name. Royston Edwards remembers turning up to work.
When I first got my first job, I used to go to work, and I had the skinhead haircut still then. Razor parting, the braces and boots and Levi's up to my knees nearly. And they hated me. People hated me at work because of what I was. Oh, he's a skinhead, that bloke. You don't speak to him. He's trouble, you know.
Emperor Roscoe, a white American reggae DJ during this period, recalls playing records to the skinheads.
They caused a lot of trouble at the gigs I went to, and I would quite often even be told by the manager and the security, don't do this or don't play that, because that's a signal. Everybody will start to punch up. And there was some instrumentals that were always, little signals to start the war. And occasionally I'd screw up and forget and play something, and then the brouhaha would start, and they'd clear the place and we'd leave early.
But generally, the skinheads just loved reggae music, and their purchasing power helped Trojan expand. Dave Barker from Dave and Ansel Collins remembers them turning up to gigs.
They at times made the loudest noise. And they also seemed to know a lot about me. They would ask me things that I had forgotten about, who I recorded for, and, you know, in Jamaica, and guys like Lord Chalmers, Duke Reid, Cox and Dodd, Harry J, you know, and they were just absorbing the music. You know, they were really into the music.
Reggae, 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 reggae. Reggae, 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 reggae.
Dave Katz.
Their purchasing of Jamaican music just helped to, again, solidify it, make it that this is an actual music of importance in Britain. And you had a whole series of hits that were like skinhead anthems.
Reggae, reggae, inna ye jeggae. Come hit me reggae, reggae, inna ye jeggae.
One such anthem was the curiously named Reggae in Your Jeggae by Dandy. But what was a jeggae?
That's a good question. I've been asked this a couple of times before. Reggae in your jeggae. I don't know. It's maybe I was thinking about your soul, ain't the soul, you know. I left it at the time to the imagination.
Thanks to the skinheads, Trojan sold about 120,000 copies of the song in 1969. The skinhead classic anthem has to be Skinhead Moonstomp by Simmerin, which again sold in huge numbers for Trojan in this year. Not many people realise the song's origins are from an early Jamaican hit by Derek Morgan.
When men start to go on moon, one day I just sit around the piano, I was strumming the piano, and we just said, well, let's record this, because it sounds good. And we just record that rhythm. I didn't have no song for it. So what I did now, I go around the mic after and just start a chant. Yeah, 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 you know, and go on with things and do the moon hop on them thing and so on. The tune become a big number one seller. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Simmerit, who were the Pyramids spelt backwards for contractual reasons, re-recorded the track for the skinhead audience. Lead singer Roy Ellis recalls its inception.
We used to play Moon Hop because it came out before Skinhead Moon Stomp. But in the same month came out from Derek Morgan, we learned it to play live. And then we see there was a great success with the record. You know, we say, yeah, 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 yeah. The skinheads go crazy. And then the producer, Graham Goodall, said, why don't you use the rhythm and just write the words and write about something different? Derek Morgan singing about Moon Hop and they write something about skinheads. It was like a joke. But it turned out to be a good joke, you know what I mean? I'm still laughing, you understand?
I want all you skinheads to get up on your feet. Put your braces together and your boots on your feet. And give me some of that old moon stamping. Get ready. We got 3 million miles to reach on the moon. Before we reach on the moon, fellas, we gotta make sure that everything is thick and strong. All right? You gotta make sure you shine your booty. Brush your teeth, because the man on the moon looking different from man on the earth. That's what I say, boy. Now remember, I'm your boss, Skinhead speaking. My name is Caleb.
It was the skinheads' buying power that would really break Trojan into the charts and give reggae music a profile in Britain for the first time. I'll leave you with another skinhead and Trojan classic, The Liquidator by the Harry J. All-Stars, which reached number 9 in 1969. This is Don Letts, over and out.